Emotional. It makes me passionate, and I reach out to him because I need him, not because I've done anything. A lot of people, I've talked to people, and they say, oh, I could never go to church. I could never be a Christian. And my question is, exactly what is it about a person who makes them a Christian? It's not them, but it's Christ in us. Paul talks about it. That's the hope that we have. That's the ability that we have. And I'm thrilled. I've been doing devotions with Malachi. He was calling them devotions for a little while. And we got him squared away, but doing devotions with him, and he thrilled me the other day. We were talking about about salvation, and I said, "What is it about the Holy Ghost, buddy? Like, what does it do for you?" And I was looking for the fact that, you know, the Holy Ghost is the comforter, and that it, you know, it leads you. And then he came right out and he said, "It shows you the right things." And I'd been talking to him as though there was a house and your body's a temple. And I'd been talking to him about baptism. I said, "Repentance is like you've gone around and you've picked up all the clutter. That's something you can do." I said, "But you don't have the ability to wash things." I said, the only thing that can do that is the blood of Jesus Christ. I said, "When you're baptized, it washes that sin away and it cleans you." I said, "But still, there's some stains that you're not able to get out without help. And sometimes we don't notice things. And the Holy Ghost will point to things." You know, living for God and being saved is not a, "Hey, I've done it." That doesn't happen until the end. It's a process. And you're continually working on yourself. And you're continually having to find those things that God would have be different and change them. And so he came out and he said, "Yeah," he said, the Holy Ghost," and I pointed out to him earlier, but he said, "The Holy Ghost is like, hey, there's a stain right over here that needs to be taken care of." Amen. And it's right. It's right on, because I have a lot of stains in my life. Amen. And some of them were there, you know, a long, long time ago. And some of them were there just from recent things that I've done, right? And some of them I've been working on for a long, long time. But God's still working on me, and it's His grace that saves me. I don't have to try and save myself. I can't save myself. I'm completely lost whenever I try to justify myself. But by the justification of Jesus' blood, I am saved by His grace, and I'm so thankful for that. And that's because He loved me. I'm going to sing an old song tonight. In fact, I was laughing at myself because I was like, I haven't even heard that song in so long that the verses seem almost unfamiliar. But love lifted me. Rise no more.
Because you were. praise, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. We praise you.
So we're going to take up our offering now. I'm going to choose our visitor here in the semi-front row to take up our offering. Would you like to take up our offering, Brother Doucette? That's okay. I've got to take some time to set up anyway and open this water bottle. I know I'm going to need it. Very thankful for everybody that told me before service that they were looking forward to hearing me speak. And as I told them, I am probably a lot less looking forward to it. I'd never like getting up behind this pulpit. It feels very, very fancy for me. I much prefer to just sit down and have a conversation, but I'm trying to pretend that I'm doing that. But I'm happy to be here in the house of the Lord tonight. Happy to be here with this church, my home church. With all the wonderful people that are here and that are watching online. I'm very thankful to be here. And, you know, there's nothing special about just the building itself, but it's about the people of God. When they gather together and we're all together in one place, we're able to worship God, that things begin to move. Thank you very much, Carmen. And I'll just have you be seated for just a few moments, but still settling in. But there's nothing special about just the building itself, but it's about when people, imperfect people, brought together by a perfect God, are able to gather and worship and just be in the presence of the Lord, that things begin to happen. Right. Amen. And James, if you'll just stand and pray over the service before we go any further.
Lord, I thank you for tonight, God. I pray that your word will go forth, God. I pray that you will open our ears to hear, God. I pray that you will open our eyes to see, God. I pray that you open our hearts and minds. Lord, I pray that conviction will set in this place, God. I pray that you will anoint Tyler as he brings forth the word. And God, I pray that you will change someone's mind and change their heart tonight. In Jesus' name.
Amen. Thank you, James. Amen. If you'll turn with me in your Bibles to Ecclesiastes, we're going to go to chapter 9. We're going to be reading verses 10 to 12. When you get there, say amen. I don't know about any of our youth here, but I remember when Dad would do sword drill with us in youth class. That was always a good time. It's always good to know your Bible and be able to get the passages quickly when you're looking for them. And for all of those using the wall Bible tonight, I'm going to be reading from the NASB, but it's the same message, it's the same word of God. And it says in verse 10, "Whatever your hand finds to do, do it with all your might. For there is no activity or planning or knowledge or wisdom in Sheol where you are going. Again, I saw under the sun that the race is not to the swift, and the battle is not to the warriors, and neither is bread to the wise, nor wealth to the discerning, nor favor to men of ability, for time and chance overtake them all. Moreover, man does not know his time, like fish caught in a treacherous net and birds trapped in a snare. So the sons of men are ensnared at an evil time when it suddenly falls on them." Amen. Tonight I want to preach on, if I was to give a title to this message, I want to preach on all your might. And as my family is well aware by now, I've been studying a lot about Japanese history on the other side of the world, going back and all the rich culture and history that it's in, that beautiful nation of Japan, and all the things like the samurai and the ninja and all the things of feudal Japan. And I'm sure they're sick of hearing it, but they're going to have to hear it tonight from the pulpit, so you can't do anything about it. But, and they've heard lots of it. Every time I learn something new, I've been reading book and book after book and watching lots of documentary series, and I'm sure that Carrie is very tired of hearing about the samurai. But that's all right. I like it. Samurai are cool. And if you disagree, we can meet after service and we'll have a nice, calm, and unbiased discussion on why you're wrong. But 500 years ago in Japan was not a unified nation by any means. This time period in Japan is actually called the Sengoku period, which is Japanese for thousand nation or thousand country, because the nation of Japan was nothing like it is today as a mighty unified nation, but it was splintered into a thousand pieces with men of war reigning over their clan's territory, over the territory of their family and of their friends. There was no unified force in Japan. There was still an emperor, but he was just a position in Japan, just a formality, just a reminiscence of the past. And they were in the middle of a large, brutal civil war as these families and these clans would compete for territory, and they would fight one another for the best lands to grow their crops and for the best cities to take over and to tax and to grow their own empire. And in the middle of all this chaos, in the middle of the 16th century, one of the most powerful and well-known men in all of Japanese history came to power of his own small clan. His name was Oda Nobunaga. Everybody wants to say Oda Nobunaga. I can't even say it. I learned some Japanese tonight. And as a side note, last names come first in Japan, and first names comes last. So if I say a name, the first part's the last part, and the last part's the first part. Right? Nobody's confused? Clear as mud for good? All right. But he took over his home province as Owari when his father died. And he owned the bottom half, the south half of the province, and his cousin ruled the northern half. And everybody thought that Nobunaga was going to very quickly be killed and someone else would take his place, as other people were very critical of him and his ability to rule. But very soon, his non-traditional tactics would bring him to not only the head of his whole clan and his whole family, but very quickly to one of the most powerful positions in all of Japan. He very quickly began forging an empire, looking to reunify the country under his own banner and to bring Japan out of the age of the warrior and into an age of peace, like it had once been in legends long past. And of course, one cannot run an empire on his own. So he began to appoint different men in his army for different positions. Some would rule over different territories in his land, and some would clean his house. Some would go and work his farms, another would collect his taxes for him. And while I love the character of Oda Nobunaga, and he's an especially important character in Japanese history, I want to focus on one of his servants for a bit. One man named Hideyoshi. Everybody say Hideyoshi. I like this. This is fun. One man named Hideyoshi came into the service of Nobunaga. And Hideyoshi was a very, very poor man. I don't know if you've ever heard the phrase. I've heard the phrase, they're so poor it couldn't afford a last name. But Hideyoshi literally could not afford a family name. His family didn't have a heritage in Japan. They didn't have a last name. There wasn't any empire of the Hideyoshi family. Hideyoshi didn't have any last name. There was no clan. He was just Hideyoshi. His parents had their own names and he had his own name. And when he died, there would be no recollection of who he was or who came before him or who came afterward. But he came into the service of Nobunaga as he began his conquest of Japan. And as a poor man, he didn't rise to the position of lord or a great samurai. He didn't become anybody particularly special at first, but his job was just to hold his lord's shoes. That was it. He was called a sandal bearer, and he was one of many. If anybody is familiar with our Bible school girls and their closets, you'll have an idea of roughly how many shoes Oda Nobunaga had. Or if you're familiar with James's closet, it's about the same. But Hideyoshi, that was his whole job in Nobunaga's service. He was given his rice to survive on. He was given a place to sleep at night because he would hold his lord's shoes. He was ready and waiting for any time that he needed them, when he wanted to change into his slippers or get into his boots. He just held Nobunaga's shoes. And Hideyoshi is well known now in Japanese history because he came from being a nobody in Japanese society. He was at the same level as the slaves and as the poorest people in Japan. He had no position. His whole job was just to hold shoes. But he distinguished himself from all the other sandal bearers, because while everybody else was making sure not to drop their lord's shoes and make sure they didn't get damaged, make sure they stayed out of the water and off of rough rocks, and to hold them and be ready as soon as
Nobunaga called for them, Hideyoshi would stuff them under his shirt against his own skin to keep them warm when Nobunaga wanted his shoes. And that alone was enough to catch his lord's attention. That extra mile, that extra step, doing more than he was required to, just a little bit for the comfort of his lord, looking out for his lord's interests, was enough to start him on a path of promotion that he would become a samurai, and he would become an owner of large lands and of large armies of his own. And years later, when Nobunaga was betrayed and killed by one of his most trusted generals, it was Hideyoshi, now Toyotomi Hideyoshi, who would rush to the rescue and avenge his lord and take over all of Japan and finish his lord's conquest. Hideyoshi started off with no name, just Hideyoshi, no family name, no clan, no territory, nothing special. And he was given a name when he distinguished himself from everybody else, and he became Toyotomi Hideyoshi. Everybody's going home with tongue twisters tonight. By the way, I fell off my notes a long time ago, so I got embroiled in Japanese history, so you might get more than is in my notes. But Hideyoshi, when Nobunaga died, he rose to become the head power in Japan as his lord's avenger and as the one who came to finish what Nobunaga started. Nobunaga never completed unifying Japan in his own lifetime. He was betrayed before he ever could. And Hideyoshi was able to go forth and finish his lord's dream in his memory. In a more familiar story, a man born in the middle of a lavish nation of Ur left everything he knew to go into uncharted territory, to serve a god unknown to his people. He was raised in a pagan nation and likely was raised worshiping pagan gods himself. No doubt hundreds of them, or at least dozens, household gods and gods of the river, gods of the weather, gods of the harvest. And suddenly one day he was called to leave all of that by a god he hadn't known before. To go to a place that he had never been before. To leave his family behind and to leave everything that he knew behind. And to worship this not new god, but new to him. And so, in faithfulness, he left everything. He left his father after he died, and took his wife and his nephew, and went to a place that he was told he'd be promised, with no further proof than just the assurance of a promise. Of course, we know this man to be Abram, a man whose name means exalted father, or something like a respected elder. You imagine naming your son, you know, great old one. It's essentially what Abram's name meant, exalted father. I think it'd be very strange to name your son dad. In Genesis 17, if you'll turn there with me quickly. I don't intend to have a long message tonight. I just want to be quick and drive home a point. And I hope that you enjoy it. But in Genesis 17, verses 1 to 5, it says, "Now when Abram was 99 years old, the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, 'I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless. I will establish my covenant between me and you, and I will multiply you exceedingly.' Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, 'As for me, behold, my covenant is with you, and you will be a father of a multitude of nations. And no longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be called Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations.'" And Abraham means a father of a multitude. There's something interesting with this last year of Bible school, able to start learning Hebrew, as if Greek wasn't enough of a headache. But one of the most interesting lessons that we had is that when Abraham and Sarah went from being Abram and Sarai and had their names changed to Abraham and Sarah, it's a story we well know. But it takes on a whole new meaning when you look at their names in the Hebrew, because their names were changed in a specific way. They weren't just given a new name to signify, oh, it's better than before, it's different than before. But they were given a name that was actually a part of God's name. We can see it in the English, it just looks like we add an H to each of their names, and that's basically what it is in the Hebrew, but that H is more important in the Hebrew. That H is part of the term that we would now know as Yahweh. The name that the Jews would never pronounce, the name that was too holy, that they would actually get a new pen every time they wrote a character of that name because of how holy the name was. And God imparted part of his name to Abraham and Sarah, signifying not only are they new creatures, everybody knows, we all know here that he who is born again in Christ is a new creature. But not only were they new, they had the mark of God on their lives, signified in their name. Because Abraham had been willing to leave his country, willing to leave his people and to start anew and to serve God with all of his heart. He was given a new name, and so was Sarah. Similar to Toyotomi Hideyoshi, who was given a new name because of his status and power that came from him giving that little bit extra, going the full way and doing everything he had for his Lord's comfort and service. He did more than he was asked to, but he did everything that he could. There is something that will happen in our own lives when we give more than just what we're needing to give. Amen? It's wonderful to, it's important to give your tithes, and it's important to show up for church, and it's important to play your part, but there's a greater role to be played than just checking off boxes. Amen? But God has put his name on us. We are adopted into his family. We're grafted into the tree of God. We are given that new family heritage. Amen. Are you glad that you have a new family heritage, that we are not forgotten in God's mind, but we are remembered in God's mind? Amen. For both Hideyoshi and Abraham, their lives changed when they began to serve their new masters with the best of their efforts. For Hideyoshi, it meant stuffing his Lord's shoes under his shirt and keeping them, however dirty they may have been from the day's journey, against his stomach to keep them warm. For Abram, it meant leaving behind everything he ever knew, his childhood and his ancestors, the gods that he had once served, his people and his city, to go and serve a foreign god in the wilderness. Of course, this isn't the end of either of their stories. Both men soon after had their own struggles. Amen. Anybody in this room can testify that just because you follow God doesn't mean your life's perfect. Amen. I know I have my struggles. I've had my struggles in the past week, in the past month. Amen. But it does mean that you have someone else that you can turn to that you couldn't turn to before.
Right.
It does mean that we have a God who is listening and who cares and who is watching out for us. Amen. The Bible says that he clothes the grass of the field. How much more will he care for his children? Amen. My focus tonight is just that Abraham and Hideyoshi, though in vastly different lands at vastly different points in time, when they gave more than everybody else around them, they were recognized for it and promoted to new status. Abraham, even though having left everything behind in Ur, became one of the richest people in the land and became the father of nations. If you weren't aware, Abraham not only is the father of the Israel nation, the Jewish nation, but also of the majority of Muslim nations in the world. Well over a billion people can claim direct ancestorship with Abraham. And Hideyoshi began to unify Japan and completed unifying Japan and making the nation that we know today one nation. These men, because they started off in humble origins and were willing to give everything, became massive figures in history, changing the shape of the world. How much more can we in our age do when we give our all to God?
Right.
Amen. Not only were Abraham and Hideyoshi's names changed, but later on we know the story of Jacob, when Jacob would go into the wilderness. And Jacob, his name originally meaning supplanter. I don't know what it is with Bible people naming their kids just these awful names. Abraham's dad calls him Dad. And Jacob is named the supplanter, the usurper, you know, basically the treacherous one. It's a wonderful name to have. My name means fixer. That's special. You know, fixer or literally a tiler, you know, fix the roof and stuff. Alan, don't get any ideas. It's probably too late for that, but anyway. But Jacob was given a new name when he would spend all night toiling with God. He could have let go at any moment. meant. He could have shoved away and decided, I'm not going to deal with this anymore. I'm not going to toy with this. The night before he went to meet Esau, but he wrestled with the angel of the Lord all night. And as a reward for that, he had his leg pushed out of place, his hip pushed out of place. And he was given a new name, Israel. And Israel means he who struggles or he who wrestles with God. It just goes to show how much more God has in store for us than just when we give what we need to, we move beyond into doing what we can do. If Hideyoshi had been willing to just settle for doing what he was told to do, doing what he was called to do, just filling out the job description, he never would have risen the ranks and never would have become eventually the prime minister of all Japan. If Abram hadn't been willing to go into the wilderness and abandon everything, I don't know that there would be an Israel, at least not an Israel that we recognize today. He is the father of faith, and he is the reason that we are here today, Abram and his faith. If it hadn't been for Abram, we don't know what would have happened. Jacob wouldn't have been born. Israel wouldn't have been made of Jacob. The Christians wouldn't be here, and we wouldn't know God. And if it wasn't for Jacob being willing to wrestle with God all the night long, then we wouldn't have the nation of Israel. If it wasn't for Jacob willing to go after what was more than his, we all know the story of Jacob taking Esau's birthright, not only his birthright, but his blessing later on in life, stealing it from his brother and becoming a great nation from which came the Savior, Jesus Christ. Like I said, I don't have a whole lot to say tonight. But just that there is more than just doing what we need to.
Right.
I've heard James say before, you go from a point in your Christianity, you go from a point in your walk with God to from what do I have to do? What do I need to do in order to be saved? How do I get to heaven by just the skin of my teeth? How do I serve God with just the bare minimum? And you move to a place to what can I do for God? What more can I do for you, Jesus? What more can I do for your kingdom? In my studies recently, I discovered the existence of a group of people, they're Christians in philosophy only. And I did not know that was a thing until recently. But essentially, their belief system is they really like the teachings of Jesus, but they don't believe in God. So they're Christian atheists. Figure that one out. I don't know how you manage that. But they don't believe in the supernatural. They dislike some of the things that Jesus had to say. One of their favorite things is the Sermon on the Mount. And they just like what Jesus has to say about peace and love. I think they're hippies with a different name. Amen. But they stop halfway. I'm sure that all of us really appreciate the stories that Jesus taught and the things that he told his disciples, the lessons that we have from him about our morality, about our spirituality, about our walk with God, about our blessings and about the love of God. And about how we are to extend that to other people. I'm sure that all of us appreciate that. And none of us would be here if it wasn't for that. But there's more to it than just the philosophy. There's more to it than just the teachings of Jesus that are in the Word. But there's a relationship to be gained. There is power in the name of Jesus beyond just what he taught 2,000 years ago. There is power in the name of Jesus more than just the philosophy that was taught on a mountain. And I'm not saying that's not important, because it is. But there's also power in the fact that we had a God who came to this earth and died for us.
Right.
Suffered for our sins and our transgressions. One of the most powerful sermons I've ever listened to was actually given by James. James, I pick on you a lot from up here, I realize. Sorry, not sorry, but one of the most powerful sermons I ever heard was at Bible school from James. And James just spent probably a half hour or 40 minutes describing the pain that Jesus would have gone through on the cross. And that is something that I've never forgotten. I'm sure many of us can think of many sermons that have stuck with us, and many others have gone through us. We have gotten from them what we needed. They've kept us alive. They've kept us going this far, but we can't remember them anymore. But that sermon stuck with me because Jesus went far further than just the bare minimum. Jesus could have come to this earth, said, hi guys, nice to meet you. Here's a couple of healings. Here's a couple of blessings. Heal the lepers and raise the dead to life. And skedaddled and gone on his way. But we wouldn't have the promise of the resurrection that we have now. We wouldn't have the grace of Jesus that we have now. Amen. Is anybody thankful for the grace of God in their lives?
Amen.
Is anybody thankful that Jesus didn't stop halfway?
Amen.
If we can just go, as I come to an ending here, if we go back to Ecclesiastes 9 and 10. For some reason, I undid my bookmark. I had it bookmarked, and I undid it. I don't know if you'll get to it before me or not. Yeah, he did. Whatsoever thy hand findeth to do, do it with thy might. For there is no work, nor device, nor knowledge, nor wisdom in the grave, whither thou goest. And just into verse 11. I returned and saw unto the sun that the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong. I like to have a lot of competitions. I used to race a lot as a kid, and now I wrestle with the guys when I get the chance. But it's not about in competition. It's not just about who's the fastest or who's the strongest, because if you only go halfway to the finish line, you didn't win. It's not about how fast you can get there. It's not about who can throw the most weight around, who can shove someone the hardest, whatever. It doesn't matter how strong or how fast you are. It doesn't matter how wise or how rich you are. It doesn't matter how skillful you are, how talented you are, because things will happen to us in our life. But the important thing is that we give all of our might. We give all of our effort. It'd be an amazing thing to see what would happen if every person gave everything. And I know it's a lot to ask, but Jesus has already given us a lot.
Right.
Jesus has already given us so much more than we could have asked for. The word says that he is exceeding abundant over all that we ask or think. Mm-hmm. He's already given us more than we can ever repay. James has said before, again, I'm picking on James so much. Somebody else should say something I can quote them. But James has said before that any sacrifice we give is really no sacrifice, because God has already paid the ultimate price for us. Jesus has already experienced that death for us so that we don't have to. Amen. I've heard some powerful testimonies from one of my teachers, many of my teachers at Bible school. And one was telling us about a man who he'd actually watched pass away in his hospital bed. And this man had lived his life faithfully for God, had given everything to God his whole life. And as he was passing away in that hospital bed, he suddenly seemed to just kind of lose focus on the room around him. He wasn't seeing what was in that hospital room anymore. He wasn't feeling the pains that were coursing through his body anymore. He wasn't seeing the walls and the windows around him. And as he just stared off seemingly into nothing, he turned to Brother Chevry, who told me this testimony, and just said, "I feel the presence of God. I'm thankful that because Jesus gave everything, that is what we can expect when we someday come to the end of this life and enter into the next one. I'm thankful that because Jesus gave everything, we have a next life to go to. But we don't have forever in this world." And this is probably the biggest thing in my message tonight. We don't have forever in this world. We don't have forever to reach souls. We only have the time that we're given. We only have the time that we're on this earth right now. No one is promised tomorrow. I just heard of an accident on the way here, actually, that a friend of mine who was at the lake store yesterday was in an accident and has broken all sorts of bones all through their body. And they survived, but it only took a moment. And it could have been so much worse. But we only have the time that we're given. We only have the time that we're alive on this earth to reach souls and to minister.
It's true.
Once we're in heaven, there's no more adding to the population. There's no more bringing others into the church, because that's the limit. That's the end of it all. I don't want heaven to be half full. I don't want heaven to just have half of the buildings are full and half of the buildings are empty with souls that should have been there. With people, our friends and family and our loved ones and even our enemies that should have been there with us, should have been celebrating with us, should have been in the presence of God with us. But we have to do more than just halfway.
Right.
There's nothing that you can give that God won't outgive you for. So I think that the most important thing we can give is our all, is our everything. I'm going to come to a close. James, if you're wanting to say anything more. But that's all I have to say tonight, is that God wants more than just half of our efforts. He wants more than just half of our faith, more than just half of our ability, but he wants us to give everything for him.
Let's stand tonight. I don't know about you, but I feel a Holy Ghost conviction just rested in this place. And, you know, maybe we've been given it all. Maybe, you know, life's not easy all the time. And you're wondering, what else can I give? What else can I do? I just feel impressed to say this. I'm not going to preach, but I just feel impressed to say this. Is because the church has gone through a lot of struggle, and I know it was an awesome message that Tyler preached. And sometimes when you walk through those dark valleys, and there's been people that have been walking through the valley of the shadow of death in the church. I'm not going to deny that. I'm not going to pretend that hell isn't breaking loose in some people's lives. I'm not going to pretend that life is perfect for everybody. And you know, sometimes it feels like you're at the end of the rope, saying, God, I know I want to give more, but I don't have much more to give. And maybe you'll never be known in this life. And I'll say this. This is something that I've never shared. This is something that I shouldn't even share. But this was just a part of my commitment to God. I told God one day. And I said, I'll go wherever you want me to go. I'll do whatever you want. And I'm not saying this for my glory. I'm just saying it because it's reality of life. And I said, I'll do whatever you want me to do, God. You tell me where to go and I'll go. It doesn't matter if it's a nation that will kill me. It doesn't matter if it's a people that will eat me. It doesn't matter what happens. I'll go. If it's you tell me to go to Texas, I'll go. You tell me to go to the Arctic, I'll go. You tell me to go to Russia. And God said, I'll send you places, but he said, on one condition. He said, you're going to walk through some valleys and your name will never be known. And he said, will you go? And at that moment, you know, as a second year Bible school student, it kind of hit my pride because everyone, you know, you want to, whether we say it or not, everybody looks to the Because of the Times preachers, or everybody looks to the pastors that are known, or to the churches that seemingly have it all together. And you want that because you want life to be all together all the time, but sometimes it's not. And I had to make up in that moment that even if I have to walk through hell, even if I have to go to a place that wants to kill me and my family, even if I have to walk through some storms, I'll be committed and I'll keep going. I'll keep walking. And I believe that God is asking this church today, and I feel conviction. Maybe it's just me. Maybe this message was just for me. But man, do I ever feel a conviction of God sitting in the room asking, will you keep going? Will you keep giving more? Will you walk where nobody walks? Abraham, he came from a godless nation that wasn't special, like Tyler said. There was wickedness all around, and he had to step out in faith to walk into the wilderness. How many people want to walk into the wilderness to give it all to God? I'll be honest, I don't. I don't want to walk into the storm. I don't want to walk into the trouble. I don't want to walk into the heartache. I don't want to walk into it. But if that's where God calls us, if that's what we have to walk through, then we can't stop in that. I shouldn't reference a song, but it's a country song. And the message is so true, is if you're going through hell, keep on going, because you might get out before the devil even knows you're there. So if you're walking through something tonight, have confidence that God knows where you are. And that you can give more. It might not be a lot. None of us are billionaires in here, and we can't fix everybody's problems. If we could, I know we all would. If we all played the lottery and one of us won, I know that everybody's heart is so pure in here that we'd fix each other's problems. But the church struggles. And the reality is, and you know, modern Christianity, I'm saying this, and we're going to open the altars, but modern Christianity will tell you that Jesus suffered and struggled so you don't have to. That's not the truth. Jesus suffered and struggled, so we know how to suffer and struggle as well. Jesus went to the cross, so we know how to carry the cross. Jesus did what he did, so we can have a confidence that if he did it and gave it all,
That I have an assurance that even if I lose my life, even if I die trying, I know I have a Savior who bought me, who redeemed me, who paid the price for me. And not only did he suffer to be an example to us of just keep walking, he suffered because in the fellowship of his suffering is where we know him. So if you're walking through that hard place tonight, if you're walking through that valley and you're hearing the message of give more, do more, and you're wondering, how can I do it? I promise you can. You never know what, there might be just a tipping point. And I'm going to open the altars. If we can just shut the recording down. I'd like to.